Hello students, welcome to science class. So in previous video we have learned about photosynthesis, how plants get their nutrition. So here about photosynthesis you have learned how plants make their food. So as you know that leaves are the food factory of the plants, and they synthesize food by the help of chlorophyll, sunlight, carbon dioxide, water and minerals. And during the photosynthesis, chlorophyll containing cells of leaves in the presence of sunlight use carbon dioxide and water to synthesize carbohydrate. So, and this process, it means that process of photosynthesis can be represented as an equation. So I'm showing you an equation. First, carbon dioxide plus water, and in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll gives carbohydrate plus oxygen. So carbon dioxide plus water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll gives carbohydrate and oxygen. What does it mean? It means that during the process of photosynthesis, oxygen is released. Oxygen and carbohydrate. So the carbohydrates ultimately get converted into starch. And you know that it is So we can say the presence of starch in leaves indicates the occurrence of photosynthesis. It means after the process of photosynthesis only carbohydrate may. So the presence of starch in leaves indicate the occurrence of photosynthesis. And the starch is also a carbohydrate only. See, this figure, this is the stomata. As I told you, that's very small pores in the leaves. See, this is the leaf. Now when we zoom it, this part, you can see here GERD cell. This is the stomata, and these dots are there, no? That these dots are chlorophyll. Now again, when we zoom this stomata, this one. So here GERD cells like dots, this is the stomata opening, and this is the diagram of photosynthesis. See, now roots absorbs water and minerals from the soil. Now it gives this water and mineral to the stem. Now stem carry this water and minerals to the leaves. Now already chlorophyll is present in leaves, and by the help of carbon dioxide and sunlight, leaves prepare their food by the process of photosynthesis. Okay, now we'll see that activity 1.1. Here you have to take two potted plants of the same kind and same height, everything same only. Now what you have to do? Keep one in the dark room, or you can keep this in a box also, black colored box. So here you have to keep this plant till 72 hours. So it means that without 72 hours, without sunlight, and that second plant in the sunlight 72 hours. After that, have you remember iodine test which you performed in class 6? So perform iodine test with the help with the leaves of both the plants. It means one you kept in a dark room and one you kept in a sunlight. After that you will record your result. Now leave the pot which was earlier kept in the dark in the sunlight again for 3 or 4 days, and perform the iodine test again. So again, record your observation in your book. So the leaves other than green also have chlorophyll. It means some way that some red color spot is there on leaves, some brown color spot is there on leaves. So the large amount of red, brown and other pigment mask and some green color. So photosynthesis take place in these leaves also. And you know that sometime when you go somewhere and on the way, you see that some in stagnant water specially, some green patches in the pond, or you see that in some other stagnant water also. So these are generally formed by the growth of organism called algae. So this is algae only. So algae is green in color. It means they also contain chlorophyll, which give them green color. So, and one, have you ever seen that if once you see that algae, some amount of algae is small, after many days if you pass that on same way, you can see some large amount of algae covered. It means that they also grow. So algae can also prepare their own food by the photosynthesis. Then only they can grow, no? So synthesis of plant food other than carbohydrate. That one thing only you know, that plants synthesize carbohydrates through the process of photosynthesis. Now the carbohydrates are made of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. See that carbohydrate. Now carbohydrates are made up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. So these are used to synthesize other components of food, such as protein and fat. It means in carbohydrate three things are there: carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. So these three are used to synthesize other components of food, such as protein and fat. But one thing again, protein are nitrogenous substance, which if protein is nitrogenous substance, it means protein contain nitrogen. So from where do the plant obtain nitrogen? Again one question arises. So have you remembered that nitrogen is present in abundance in gaseous form in the air? That also you had learned in 6th standard. So amount of nitrogen in the air. How much amount of nitrogen is there in air? So maximum amount of nitrogen in the air. It means that nitrogen is present in gaseous form in the air. But plants cannot absorb nitrogen in this form, and soil has contained bacteria that convert gaseous nitrogen into usable form and release it into soil. It means in the soil some bacteria are present which convert gaseous nitrogen into usable form and then release it into soil. Now these soluble forms are absorbed by the plants along with water. It means these soluble forms are absorbed by the roots of the plant along with water. Now you might have seen farmers also adding fertilizers rich in nitrogen to the soil. So in this way also plant fulfill their requirement of nitrogen. Along their other constituents. So plant can then synthesize component of food other than carbohydrates and such as proteins and fats. Now we'll learn some other modes of nutrition in plant. Now have you ever seen that there are some plants which do not have chlorophyll, because as you know, because of chlorophyll only leaves has their green color, but there are some plants which do not have chlorophyll. They cannot synthesize their food. Why? Because chlorophyll is not present in the leaves. That's why they cannot synthesize their food. So how do they survive? And from where do they derive their nutrition? See, now as you know that humans and animals depend on the food produced by the plants. So like humans and animals, such some plants also there that depend on the food produced by other plant. So they use the heterotrophic mode. Which mode? They use that heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Some plants are there which have that yellow tubular structures. Here on page number 5 also you can see this one. So here this picture you can see. So here yellow tubular structures twining around the stem and branches. So this is a plant called Cuscuta. Which Cuscuta plant is there? It means amarbel also we can say. Cuscuta or amarbel plant. So it does not have chlorophyll. Why? Because that yellow color tubular form is there. It means here no chlorophyll is present. So it takes ready-made food from the plant. Because you know that yellow color tubular form is there, it means it does not have chlorophyll. So without chlorophyll, they cannot perform the process of photosynthesis. That's why it takes ready-made food from the plant. So on which it is climbing. Now one more thing, the plant on which it climbs is called host. And since it deprives the host of valuable nutrients, it is called parasite. It means the plant on which the climbs, it is called host. And since it deprives the host of valuable nutrients, it is called a parasite. Now, have you ever seen or heard of plants that can eat animals? This is very, you know that. So there are few plants which can trap insects and digest them. It is amazing only, no? So how that plants can trap insects and digest them? But this type of plants are there. Such plants may be green or of some other color. Now you know one more type of plant is there, that is pitcher plant. Here you can see that figure 1.6, this one. This is the pitcher plant. Here the pitcher like structure is the modified part of the leaf. This one, leaf modified into pitcher. Pitcher like structure, it modified like part of the leaf. And the apex of the leaf form a lid which can open and close. This one. This is the lid. So the lid which can open and close the mouth of the picture. So inside the picture there are hair here. Inside the picture here you can see some hair which are directed downwards. This way, directed downwards. So when an insect land in the picture, here insect land in the picture, the lid closes and the trapped insect gets entangled into the hair, and the insect is digested by the digestive juices secreted in the picture. So such plants are called insectivorous plants. So what is the example of insectivorous plant? Pitcher plant. So you can say pitcher plant is the example of insectivorous plant. So, is it possible that such plants do not get all the required nutrients from the soil in which they grow? Usually, you know that most of the plant get all the requirement nutrients from the soil. So here one more type of mode of nutrition, that is saprotrophs. So you might have seen that some packets of mushrooms. Have you ever seen that packets of mushroom? So mushroom sold in the vegetable market only. So you may have also seen some fluffy umbrella like patches growing on rotting wood during the rainy season. Maybe you had seen during the rainy season some umbrella like structure growing, then some rotting wood or some under the tall tree. So let us find out that what type of nutrients they need to survive and from where they get them. See, this way you can see this packet mushrooms. For that also I am telling you one activity. See 1.2. What you have to do, you have to take a piece of bread. Now sprinkle some very little amount of water on the bread and moisten it. So now what you have to do, leave it in a moist or warm places for 2 or 3 days. So after 3 days you can see some fluffy patches appear on them. So these patches may be different in color. So these patches may be white, may be green, may be brown, of any other color also. So now observe the patches under a microscope or a magnifying glass. If you do not have microscope, so you can observe it under a magnifying glass. This is your bread, molten bread. After that, write your observation in your book. So most probably you will see that cotton like thread spread on the piece of bread. When you touch it, that some cotton like thread spread on the piece of bread. Now what is this? So these organisms are called fungi. So they have a different mode of nutrition. First, they secrete digestive juices on the dead and decaying matter and convert it into a solution. Then they absorb the nutrients from it. And this mode of nutrition, in which organisms take in nutrients in solution form from dead and decaying matter, is called saprotrophic nutrition. So plant which use saprotrophic nutrition of mode of nutrition are called saprotrophs. So here you can give example of saprotrophs, fungi. It means that fungi is the example of saprotrophic nutrition. See now. And again one thing, that during the rainy season, fungi spoil many things. Now some fungal spores are generally present in the air. Already in air many that some fungal spores are present. So when they land on wet and warm things, they germinate and grow. So what happened when fungal spores land on the wet and warm things, they germinate and grow. It means day by day they grow. So some organisms live together and share shelter and nutrition. This is called symbiotic relationship. Here one more Some organisms live together and share shelter and nutrients. This is called symbiotic relationship. For example, I am telling you, certain fungi live in a roots of tree. Have you ever seen that some type of fungi lives in a roots of tree? So the tree provides nutrients to the fungus and in return receives help it to take up water and nutrients from the soil. Again, some type of fungi live in the roots of tree, so the tree provides nutrients to the fungus. Now in return, tree receives help from it to take up water and nutrients from the soil. Now this association is very important for the tree. So this is symbiotic relationship, give and take. So in organisms called lichens, a chlorophyll containing partner, which is an algae, and a fungus live together. Thus, fungus provide shelter, water and mineral to the algae, and in return the algae provides food which is prepared by the photosynthesis. Again I am telling, one organism lichen, a chlorophyll containing partner which is an algae, it means in algae chlorophyll is present, and the fungus which is not in green color, it means it does not have chlorophyll. So the fungus provide shelter, water and mineral to the algae. Because fungus is not in green color, it does not have chlorophyll, it cannot perform the process of photosynthesis. So fungus provide algae a shelter, water and mineral. And in return, algae provides food which is prepared by photosynthesis, because algae can prepare food because it has chlorophyll. So this is again symbiotic relationship. So what is the example of symbiotic relationship? Lichens. So lichens is the example of symbiotic relationship. Okay, so now you know that 1, 2, 3, this many plants get nutrition from the soil. So now how nutrients are replenished in the soil? So you may know that farmers spreading manure and fertilizers in the field, and garden also that we spread some manure or fertilizers, or sometime using them in a lawns or in pots also. So why they added these nutrients in the soils? You learn that plants absorb mineral and nutrients from the soil. So what will happen? So their amount in the soil keep on declining day by day. What will happen? You have learned that plants absorb water and mineral and nutrients from the soil. So what will happen? Day by day, amount of minerals and nutrients in the soil keep on declining. Therefore, fertilizers and manure contain plant nutrients such as nitrogen, potassium and phosphorus etc. be added in the soil. So these nutrients need to be added from time to time to enrich the soil. So if we add some nutrients to the soil, so we can grow plants and keep them healthy, if we can fulfill the nutrient requirement of the plant. You know that usually crops require a lot of nitrogen to make proteins. So after the harvest, soil become deficient in nitrogen. Because you know that some crops require lots of nitrogen to make protein. So what will happen? So day by day that day by day amount of nitrogen will be decreases in the soil. So after harvesting, the soil becomes very deficient in the nitrogen. So plants cannot use one more thing in air also, that amount of nitrogen is there, plenty of amount of nitrogen is there, but again plants cannot use it in the manner they can use carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide plant directly can use from the atmosphere, but nitrogen cannot. They need nitrogen in a soluble form. Now again in soil, one bacterias are there. They are called rhizobium bacteria. Which bacteria? Rhizobium bacteria. Rhizobium bacteria can take atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into a soluble form. So what is the work of rhizobium bacteria? Rhizobium bacteria can take atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into a soluble form. But again one more thing, that rhizobium bacteria cannot make its own food. So it lives in the roots of gram, peas, mung, beans and other legumes and provides them with nitrogen. So most of the pulses, or we can say dals, are obtained from leguminous plant, and in return the plants provide food and shelter to the bacteria. Now they thus have symbiotic relationship. Again they have symbiotic relationship only, no? So the association of great significance for the farmers. They do not need to add nitrogen fertilizers to the soil in which leguminous plants are grown. So here you had learned that most of the plants are autotrophs. Again I am telling, most of the plants are autotrophs. Autotrophs means which can make their food by their own. And and only a few plants adopt their modes of nutrition like parasitic and saprotrophic. Many, it means small amount of plants are there which can adopt their some other modes of nutrition like parasitic and saprotrophic. Now they derive nutrition from other organisms. And all animals are categorized as heterotrophs since they depend on the plant and other animals for food. It means that we can say that plants, most of the plants are autotrophic. Why? Because they make their food by their own with the help of simple substances. And all animals are categorized as heterotrophs. Why? Because they depend on plants or other animals for food. And one more time I am telling that one plant is there, insectivorous plants. So can we say that the insectivorous plant are partial heterotrophs? Yes, because insectivorous plant trap insect into them and digest it. It means we can say it is the partial heterotrophs. So one only condition is there. See here, one more I am telling you that nutrition in plant. Nutrients, you know that carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, minerals, protein, and all living things require food. Like all living things, plants also require food, and you know that plants are autotrophs. They make their food by their own, by the process of photosynthesis. And photosynthesis also you have learned in earlier class. See, this is the process of photosynthesis. After that, some other modes of nutrition in plant, when you see that heterotrophic modes of nutrition, now about insectivorous plant, saprotrophic mode of nutrition, symbiotic relationship. So students, here we end up the lesson. In next video, hopefully I will explain that keywords and some notes of the chapter. Till then, go through the video twice for better understanding. We'll meet you soon. Thank you.